We now move on to part 2 of Schedule M, which discusses the requirements of plant and equipment. The same has been discussed under various heads, ranging from external preparations to oral liquid preparations, tablets, capsules, dressings, surgical dressings, ophthalmic preparations, repacking of drugs and pharmaceuticals and chemicals, parenteral preparations, inhalers, and parenteral preparations in glass containers. All of you are recommended to go through this entire part to understand in depth the requirements for fulfilling the GMP that is described in Schedule M with respect to all these subheadings. I will just briefly describe a couple of them to you for your better understanding. Now, in case of external preparations, Part 2 Schedule M says that the following equipment is recommended for the manufacture of the external preparations, such as ointments, emulsions, lotions, etc. And there is a list of equipment ranging from mixing and storage tanks to SS containers, mixers, planetary mixers, triple mill, triple roller mill, colloid mill, etc. The minimum area prescribed for installing these is also discussed in this section. The section on oral liquid preparations recommends a list of equipments for manufacture of oral liquid preparations such as syrups, elixirs, emulsions, and suspensions. And the list ranges from mixing and storage tanks to jacketed kettle, portable stirrers, colloid mill, filtration equipment, etc. Minimum recommended area for installation of each equipment is 30 square meters for basic installation and 10 square meters for ancillary or support areas. The third section is on tablets, and the section discusses the various unit processes involved in tableting under four different heads. A. Mixing, granulation and drying section. B. Tablet compression section. C. Packaging section. And D. Coating section where required. The list of equipments required in each of these sections is given in the section on tablets. The section on capsules discusses and lists the equipment recommended for filling of hard gelatin capsules, such as the mixing and blending equipment, capsule filling units, capsule counters, weighing balances, disintegration test apparatus, and capsule polishing equipment. In addition, the minimum area necessary for installation of these is also written under the section. Similarly, there is a section on powders and there is a section on surgical dressings, section on ophthalmic preparations. The next section is that on pessaries and suppositories, as well as inhalers and vitrilene. Last two sections are involved with the repacking of drugs and pharmaceuticals, as well as parenteral preparations. So, a manufacturer of a formulation, which is an oral liquid, has to read and comply with the requirements of plants and equipments that are given in Part 2 of Schedule M. So tomorrow, if you decide to have your own manufacturing unit, then you should know the conditions, the requirements, and the prerequisites for plant and equipment for the manufacture of different types of preparations. So the different sections that are given in Part 1 as well as Part 2 related to plant and equipment have to be complied with. Under Part 2, as I just discussed with you, each and individual type of preparation, category of preparation, is covered under this, and the equipment list of prescribed equipments has been listed and has to be necessarily available at the manufacturing premises of the manufacturer who wishes to go in for commercial manufacture of all these preparations. As a case study, I have taken here the section on requirements of plant and equipment for external preparations, that is the ointments, emulsions, lotions, solutions, etc. And the list of recommended equipments is given here with mixing and storage tanks, preferably made up of SS or any other appropriate material, a jacketed kettle, which is steam, gas or electrically heated, a planetary mixer, a colloid mill or suitable emulsifier, triple roller mill or an ointment mill, liquid filling equipment that is electrically operated, and a jar or tube filling equipment, again which is electrically operated. As I told you earlier, the recommended area is minimum of 30 square meters for basic installation and 10 square meters for ancillary area. Areas for formulations meant for external use and internal use shall be separated in order to avoid mix-up as well as cross-contamination. Okay, so this is how each and every type of preparation is given. For each and every type of preparation, there is a list of equipment, the requisite area, as well as any special instructions for the same. So all of you will open part 2, schedule M, and read the list of equipments for all types of preparations, ranging from external preparations to tablets, capsules, parenterals, ophthalmics, etc. And increase your knowledge base so that tomorrow, as responsible pharmacist, you will be in a position to comply with the requirements of the DNC Act and rules each and every time, and thus contribute to improving and maintaining the quality of the formulation with a view to patient health and safety. We have thus so far seen the various requirements as laid down in Schedule M, and these were the requirements of factory premises, plants and equipment for pharmaceutical products. Further, Schedule M was divided into part 1 and part 2. Further, as we go ahead in DNC Act and Rules, we will come across Schedule M1, which gives the requirement of factory premises for manufacturing of homeopathic preparations. Next is Schedule M2, which is requirement of factory premises for the manufacture of cosmetics, and Schedule M3, which is the requirement of factory premises for the manufacture of medical devices. These three sections, that is M1, M2 and M3, are more or less similar to Schedule M Part 1 and 2, with specific requirements related to homeopathic preparations, cosmetics and medical devices. Now, these three subsections are for self-study, and I want all of you all to open Schedule M and read it in its entirety to understand CGMP as written down by the Indian rules and regulations for the Indian pharma industry. Schedule H to the DNC rules is a list of prescription drugs that are mentioned here in alphabetical order, and this list of Schedule H drugs keeps getting updated from time to time. There is a long list of drugs, probably more than 500 drugs are listed currently in the Schedule H section of the DNC rules, and this is nothing but a summary of the different drugs that fall under this schedule. The salts, esters, derivatives and preparations of the drugs that are mentioned in this list are also covered under this schedule. So what is Schedule H drug? A drug that is to be sold on the prescription of a registered medical practitioner only, and the label of such preparation contains a Schedule H warning in a box. We have already studied this under the labeling of drugs. Herein, I have just produced the first few drugs that fall under Schedule H. If you see any of these preparations, formulations in the market, and you will definitely see the Schedule H warning. So whether it is amikacin injection or alprazolam tablets or amitriptyline tablets or acetabutylol hydrochloride tablet or aclarubicin injection, you will see the Schedule H drugs. So more than 500 drugs are listed under Schedule H, which is a list of prescription drugs. Schedule J is a list of diseases and ailments which a drug cannot claim to cure. Just read the first few diseases here and think whether there is a cure for AIDS, appendicitis. When I say cure, I mean by giving a drug. Arteriosclerosis, baldness, blindness, asthma, cataract, deafness, congenital malformations, etc. So the list is large and contains a number of diseases that cannot be cured. There are more than 50 diseases listed here which cannot be cured by giving the medications, and therefore any claim made and falling under this, and that particular drug will be misbranded and liable for penalty. Schedule N is very, very important for those who wish to have their own pharmacy or what we call as chemist shop, because Schedule N gives a list of the minimum equipment for efficient running of a pharmacy. The first 2 points I have put down here, but you can, out of self-interest and as a matter of being in the syllabus, go through the entire schedule on your own. Reading point number one, it says that the front of a pharmacy shall bear the inscription pharmacy. The second point says that premises of a pharmacy shall be separated from rooms for private use. So whatever is the premise should be used exclusively for selling of drugs, should not be used for residential or other purposes. The premises shall be well built, dry, well lit, ventilated, of sufficient dimensions to allow the goods in stock, that is the medicaments and the poisons, to be kept in a clearly visible and appropriate manner. The sections to be used for dispensing shall be not less than 6 square meters for one pharmacist working therein, with additional 2 square meters for every additional pharmacist. The height of the premises shall be at least 2.5 meters. The floor of the pharmacy shall be smooth and washable. The walls shall be plastered or tiled or oil painted to maintain smooth, durable, washable surface devoid of holes, cracks and devices. Pharmacy shall be provided with ample supply of good water. So on and so forth. There are several such requirements given in this Schedule N. There is a requirement on the furniture and the apparatus to be available in the pharmacy. By apparatus, it means beakers, balances, bottles, mortar, pestle, etc. Also books. Then there is a section on general provisions in the pharmacy. And thus, anyone wishing to have their own pharmacy should be very thorough with Schedule N, which is nothing but a list of minimum equipment for the efficient running of a pharmacy. We now look at Schedule P. Schedule P gives the shelf life of several drugs that are official. As you can see on the slide, Schedule P gives the life period of drugs, which is nothing but period in months between the date of manufacture and date of expiry, which the labeled potency period of the drug should not exceed, provided the conditions of storage are complied with. Now I have given a small part of that list here, and I will just explain to you with the help of one example. Example number 3, if ampicillin capsules, if they are stored in a cool, dry place, then their recommended shelf life is 24 months. Similarly, ampicillin trihydrate, when stored in a cool, dry place, its shelf life is 30 months. Thus, the shelf life is always expressed in months and not in days or with date as you normally happen to do in the college. Pick up any marketed formulation and see its manufacturing date and expiry date and find out the difference. It will be in months. It will be somewhere 24 months, 30 months, 36 months or whatever is prescribed in Schedule P. Or if the drug is new and has not come under Schedule P, then the manufacturer will decide and put the expiry or shelf life on the label of that particular product. We have seen under the requirements for packaging of formulations that there are standard pack sizes such as 10 individual 1, 2, 3, 4, 7, 8, 9, 10 for tablets or capsules, or you have 100 ml or 50 ml in case of liquids. However, Schedule P1 gives us the pack sizes, special pack sizes, if wherever these are applicable. So a small part of that list has been reproduced here, and you can see that these are very special packs and not complying with the standard pack sizes which we saw earlier. Albendazole suspension is only 10 ml pack size, Atenolol 14 tablets, Aspirin 14 tablets, Famotidine 14 tablets, Catalin ophthalmic drops 15 ml. So if you are making a formulation of Catalin or Atenolol or Albendazole, then you have to comply with not the general requirements but the special requirements as stated in Schedule P1. So it is very important for a manufacturer to know the pack size. He has to go through the general pack size requirements as well as specific pack sizes as stated in Schedule P1. Now we come to Schedule U, which refers to the documentation aspects of the various formulations, and it tells us about the particulars to be shown in manufacturing records. It says that where the preparation is a non-parenteral preparation, then the following data is very important and has to be recorded. And that data is serial number, name of the product, reference of the master formula record, the lot size, the lot number, date of commencement of manufacture, date when manufacture completed, names of all ingredients, control reference numbers, references to analytical report numbers, production and packing particulars, date of release of the finished packing, and signature of the staff responsible for manufacture. Also required to be shown as per Schedule U are all records of raw materials, such that records in respect of each raw material shall be maintained and indicate the quantity received, the control reference number, the quantity issued, names and batch numbers of the products for manufacture of which this raw material will be issued, and particulars relating to proper disposal of stocks. It is important to note that the licensing authority may permit the licensee to maintain records in a manner as is considered satisfactory, provided that all above basic requirements are complied with. Schedule V gives the standards for patent or proprietary medicines. In this section, there are several standards for various types of medications. For example, standards for patent or proprietary medicines containing vitamins for prophylactic, therapeutic or pediatric use shall contain vitamins in a quantity not less than and not more than those specified below in single or two divided doses, and for this purpose a table is given which has to be complied with. Another general standard for different categories of patent or proprietary medicine states that in case of pharmaceutical products containing several active ingredients, the selection shall be such that the ingredients do not interact with one another. So drug-drug incompatibility should not be there and do not affect the safety and therapeutic efficacy of the product. The combination shall not also lead to analytical difficulties for the purpose of assaying the content of each such ingredient separately. Also, the substances added as additives shall be innocuous, that is inert, shall not affect the safety or efficacy of the active ingredients, and shall not affect the assay and identity tests in the amount present. Thus, you can see that standards for patent or proprietary medicines discusses in detail the requirements with which these medicines should comply. Also, specific dosage forms have been discussed and requirements for tablets, capsules, liquid oral dosage forms, injections and ointments have been discussed, and it has been mandated that all these should comply with the general monographs of these formulations as presented in the latest edition of the Indian Pharmacopoeia. So all of you are advised to read Schedule V to understand more about the standards for patent and proprietary medicine.